Welcome to Frank Buckley Interviews. Tonight, it's a Southern California figure skater who became the first American woman to land a triple axel in Olympic competition. It's Mirai Nagasu.
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
Landing the triple axel was cause for celebration, but it was Mirai's controversial comments after her skating that got her into trouble with the media and with fans.
I felt like it wasn't fair to my teammates who did do their best performances to the best of their ability, and to have not named every single one of my teammates, I think that was not fair to them, and so I apologize because, you know, I do appreciate their efforts in the team event, and I couldn't have gotten a medal without them, and so it was a team effort, and I felt really bad that I didn't name them when I made that comment.
My conversation with figure skater Mirai Nagasu when we come back. Mirai, welcome.
Thank you.
It's good to have you here. Your story in the Olympics this year really captured our hearts, especially in Southern California, because of your parents and their story, their restaurant in Arcadia, Kyosuzu. Mm-hmm. And we all imagined their pride and joy in seeing you in the Olympics. And as I was reading about your story, it said that you, when you were growing up, would sleep in the storage closet. Tell me about that.
Yeah, we couldn't afford a babysitter. And it's funny that you say that my parents are proud of me, because I think they had to really talk to the media to bring that out of them. Growing up, they're really hard on me, and they wanted a better life for me. And being immigrants, it was hard in a different country. And so we didn't have a lot of money, but I had a big dream. And even as a young girl, I would say, I want to go to the Olympics, and this is what I want to do. And so they really supported me and made my dream a reality. And I mean, a couple years in the restaurant storage room, I look at it now and I'm like, it's too tiny for a person to sleep in it. But yeah, that's what we did. And now I'm here and too big for that storage room.
And you started skating when you were 5, right?
Yes.
Where did that come from? How do you decide at 5, I want to do that?
I don't really have any good memories of when I decided I wanted to be a figure skater, but my parents tell me that they wanted me to be a golfer because of the whole Tiger Woods, Michelle Wee, the whole scholarship thing, and how they wanted me to get a good education but also have an athletic career. And so my dad is really passionate about golfing, and so he would take me to the course every day, and he says that I ruined his dreams, which is okay. But it rained one day in California, and so they took me to the ice rink, and instead of going to the golf course every day, I would ask my parents to take me to the rink. And you know, when you're that young, how can you say no to a 5-year-old? And so it just slowly became an everyday thing.
Wow. And at what point did you realize, oh, I'm pretty good at this? Do you remember that moment?
That's the thing, is that when I was younger, I would compete, and I would get fourth place a lot. And so I'd bring a yellow ribboned medal home, and I'd be like, Mom, these judges have it all wrong. I was the best. And I always believed in myself, I guess. And so I had this undying belief that I had what it took to become a great athlete. And my mom would be like, no, you are actually really terrible, you just fell on your crossovers, which are just like the in between your skating. Yeah. And so I'd be like, oh, that was a fluke. And I guess that undying faith in myself kept me going for so many years.
I wonder, you know, when you have that though with your parents saying, well, it's a fluke, you know, fourth place, you actually weren't that good, you must have this drive within you to then, you know, excel. Mm-hmm. And how would you do that at that young age? You know, what did that mean when you had that drive? What did that translate into?
Yeah, I think growing up, watching my parents work so hard to provide me with a better future, and for them to, my dad had always wanted his own sushi restaurant, and so for him to go out and achieve that goal, to watch them work really hard to continue to make their dream a reality, I knew that it wasn't going to be easy, and so that was where I learned my drive from my parents, and watching my parents work really hard for me made me want to work hard to answer their expectations of myself. And And so I think I really am grateful to my parents for teaching me that drive and determination, and also grateful that they taught me that if I continued to work hard, that at some point in my career I would achieve what I really truly wanted.
I've talked to many elite athletes and the people who've observed those elite athletes, and they always talk about this obsession with perfection, that there's this thing where it's never enough. And did you have that as a skater?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, it's a double-edged sword, because at what point are you happy with yourself? Mm. But I think it's that goal to continually improve yourself and to better yourself that makes us better people. And you know, humanity would have come to a stop if people weren't looking to become better. And so I think that even with my Olympic performance for the team event, going into that triple axel, I know people don't know this, but I was actually tripping all over my feet. And then when I landed, it felt like a calmness came over me. But still to this day, when I look at that performance, I see a lot more of my own mistakes, even though I'm still proud of what I did.
So wait a minute. Moment. So you're one of three American women who've landed a triple axel in international competition. And it was so celebrated when it happened. And you're saying that it wasn't...
When you want something so badly for so long and then you're expected in that moment to deliver, it's a lot of pressure to put on oneself. And so going into it, I was not as calm and cool, as collected as I wanted to be, but to still have been able to perform to the best of my ability, it's something that I'm really proud of. But at the same time, that athlete in me is still like... there are some things that I could have done better. Like I could have performed a little bit better, or there's always room to improve.
So when you're doing that performance, tell me, because we watch you and we see you gliding across the ice, we hear the music. Mm-hmm. It seems, controlled and measured, and you seem like you know exactly what you're going to do next. And I wonder, in your head, what do you hear? Do you hear the sound of your skates? Do you hear the music? Or are you doing a count? What happens inside your head?
It depends on each performance. But sometimes I get so nervous that I worry that I forget that I'm going to forget how to skate. Like when I'm tying my skates, sometimes I'm so nervous. Because if you think about it, we've waited so long. Like I waited 19 years to make my dream a reality. And so to put that all on the line, I was like, oh my God, what if I'm not tying my skates correctly? There are just so many self-doubts that come in. And so I think for athletes, the best thing to do is to compete stupid and to compete with a blank mind.
Because, not to think.
Yes, yeah. Yes, because you've trained it into yourself, and there's muscle memory. It's the brain that sometimes overtakes your performance, and that's when things go downhill. Yeah.
When you finally finished that performance, so you had a moment to realize, I did it. Tell me what that felt like.
It was the greatest reward ever, and it felt like, the tears in practice when I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to deliver in that moment. It all came to fruition, and I think back on that performance, and I sometimes can't believe that I was able to accomplish that, because it's a once in a lifetime opportunity, and to have been able to grasp that opportunity and to deliver when it counted is something that I'll always remember and cherish.
Let me take you back to 2014.
Yeah.
You finished third at the U.S. Nationals, and by all accounts should have been on the U.S. Olympic team. And instead, they choose the person who was in fourth place over you, and you don't get to go to the Olympics. Tell me about that experience.
It's funny how a year ago I would have probably started to break down in tears and cried about it, but I think now it's part of who I am, and I think in our generation of millennials, we're... it's hard for us to accept rejection. And so for me to have taken that decision and decided that I wasn't going to quit, and I was going to continue to work towards another cycle, it's made me who I am and made me really proud of the person that I've become, because it's really easy to quit and to find something else you're passionate about, but it's harder to, once you're told you're not good enough for something, to say, no, I don't believe that, and then to continue on. And I think that decision made me want to become a better skater. And in our sport, we don't really learn new tricks at past 18, 19. That's when you really learn how to do your triples, and then you start to fine-tune your technique as you get older. But I decided when I was basically 24 years old that I was going to learn the triple axel, and that I wanted to be an athlete that they couldn't reject anymore. And so I think if I hadn't been rejected like that, I wouldn't have been so determined to learn a new jump and to get back onto the Olympic team. And so although it was really hard to get past, it's part of who I am now.
And you made something of it, and you did fight back, and you got back to the Olympics. And then there was controversy. Yes, you got bronze. That was a great accomplishment. Yes, you landed the triple axel. But then you made some comments that, and I'm going to remind people about some of these comments so that we can put it into context. At one point you said, I saved the team event with the Adam and the Shibutanis. We were about to lose our medal. So today I put my medal in my pocket and I said, Mirai, you've done your job already. This is all just icing. And during the news conference, you also said, I would like to be on Dancing with the Stars because I want to be a star. I made history here by landing the first triple axel for a U.S. lady at the Olympics, so I think that's a big deal. I hope I get more opportunities to let my personality just shine. And then I smiled in the middle of my program. It really is rare for me, but I enjoyed myself, and I thought of this as my audition for Dancing with the Stars. You caught a lot of heat, as you know, for those comments. Tell me what you were thinking when you said them and the context in which you said them.
I think I definitely cringe when I listen to them now. But in the moment, you know, being at the Olympics is really an honor, but still a responsibility. And it's a lot more than we're used to be in a foreign environment for so long and to be outside our comfort zone and to have so many people at every practice and a lot of media with their full attention on you. I think I wasn't quite ready to handle that. And I think that I was very disappointed in myself for not being able to deliver the triple axel a second and third time. And so I said things that I didn't quite mean. And I meant that I wanted to just enjoy my performance after I disappointed myself when I didn't land the triple axel. And yeah, it was really hard to accept, but it was a mistake that I had already made, and so I had to smile in the middle of my performance and just continue on, because it wasn't like I could take a step back and ask the judges to let me restart my program, you know. I mean, sometimes I wish that I could, but sometimes things just don't work out, and the triple axel is such a difficult jump. It's even for me, with the experience that I've had and the ability to land it, sometimes, you know, you're not able to deliver. And as far as the team event comments, I meant that more of it as like, I felt like a superhero in that day. And like, I felt like I was, you know, out there being heroic and being able to deliver when it counted really meant a lot. And to listen back to those comments that I made, I definitely wish I had worded them a little bit differently and also represented myself a little bit better. But at the same time, I'm always that person who's honest, and you never know what to expect from me. And so sometimes I do say things that I don't mean, but also at the same time, it's unapologetically myself.
Yeah, but you did later apologize for it. Yeah. Why did you feel like you needed to apologize?
I felt like it wasn't fair to my teammates who did do their best performances to the best of their ability, and to have not named every single one of my teammates, I think that was not fair to them, and so I apologize, because you know I do appreciate their efforts in the team event, and I couldn't have gotten a medal without them, and so it was a team effort, and I felt really bad that I didn't name them when I made that comment.
You are retiring from Olympic skating, is that true?
I definitely won't make it for another cycle. 4 years is a long time, and the U.S. is definitely going to produce another skater. I've been through 3 Olympic cycles already, but I'll always have a passion for skating, and it's a great way to exercise, but probably not another Olympics. But you never know, I guess, you know.
So wait a minute. So you're probably not going to make it, but you say you never know. Does that mean there's still a chance that you will try to skate?
I don't know. People do crazier things, but I find that right now, for me, I'm kind of in that floating stage, and I'm not really sure where I am with my skating. I'm just really incredibly happy with what I've accomplished so far, and also, someone once told me that floating is okay. Like, it kind of is stressful to not know where you are and to be in no man's land, but at the same time, new opportunities will hopefully arise, and embracing change is really important as well. But with skating right now, I feel like I need a little bit of a break and would like, you know, some downtime. We're actually starting up our season already, but I feel like I haven't had a break from skating, and getting training out of my body has been really hard for me. That's that consistent thing. And so I don't know where I am with my skating right now. And so right now I say I don't want to go to another Olympics, but you know, 4 years is a long time to make that decision.
So what's next?
You know, I'm trying to figure that out myself. I think that being in figure skating for so long, I used to be that shy personality until I realized that I'm more happy of the person I am when I say whatever I want to say. And yes, sometimes I have to apologize for those things, but it makes me unapologetically myself, and it makes me human to say things that I don't necessarily mean. But to be in an environment where my skating has to do the talking, and then to go outside of that and to go into the mix zone where I have to tell my story in very short sentences, and then to have the media write about me the way they want to perceive me, and then it makes me want to become a friendly face in that world, and to help people share their story, and for people to not be afraid to talk to me, because I want to showcase their lifestyle and their career in a positive light, and I want to become that positive icon where I wouldn't really necessarily write my opinion, more I would be helping people tell their own story.
And have you envisioned what form that might take?
I guess maybe as a journalist or TV anchor, or somewhere where they can talk to me, kind of like in this setting where they can really open up to me, even if it's backstage. Backstage is a lot of fun. It's where things go down, and I think that's where I kind of really want to be.
So you're not going to take my job, though?
I don't think so. You're doing a great job. I'm like, I really admire how you've been really steering this interview.
Oh, thank you. Well, please say more. I'm just kidding. And you've done some public speaking. Tell me what that experience was like.
Yeah, I was given the opportunity to talk to the workers at Liberty Mutual, who is a sponsor of Team USA. And Team USA is unique in that we are not government funded. So all of the funding that we receive are come from donations and from companies who make supportive payments, I guess is the right word. And so for me to talk to the workers at Liberty Mutual and to share my story, and for them to come back to me and to tell me that they never thought they could relate to an Olympian, and that they couldn't believe that Olympians struggle too, it was really cool to be able to relate to people and to tell them that sometimes you have to face rejection and you just have to get up and keep going. And
yeah.
So to be given that opportunity was truly, it was very fun.
Finally, I hope to be able to sit down to talk to you in a year, maybe 3 years, 5 years. Tell me what your life is going to be like over the next few years.
That's a big, heavily weighted question.
Yeah.
I think listening to your interviews with other people, I've found that people are always ever changing, and you just never know when new opportunities will arise, and based on my decisions, I'll become a different person, obviously, and who knows, I might still be skating and competing, or I don't know, but I would love to get the chance to share other people's stories, so I'll probably go back to school and take some communications classes, because I'm studying business right now, so mm-hmm. I've learned how to write a strong professional email.
Excellent.
But other than that, I'm not quite sure, but I'm told that I'm young, still 25.
I think you are.
In the skating world, I'm actually very old, so it's rare to be told that I'm still a growing person. And so I guess the limit is something that I'll put on myself, and so I'll have to push past my boundaries and find out what my limits are.
Well, you've done it before. Congratulations, and we can't wait to see what happens next.
Thank you.
My thanks to Mirai Nagasu for a wonderful conversation. We always go deeper with our guests on the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast, and we did so with Mirai. If you'd like to check it out, it's available on all of the podcast platforms, including Google Play, iTunes, and the KTLA News app. I read all of your comments on social media, and I like to retweet your positive reviews. If you'd like to send along some feedback, I'm Frank Buckley TV on Twitter and on Instagram, and there's a Frank Buckley Facebook page as well. And if you want to share today's program with friends, we post our shows on YouTube. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews. Thanks very much for watching. I'll see you next time.